Be honest, how many of you saw that coming? The Dallas Mavericks bounced back after a disappointing last-minute loss to the Portland Trail Blazers by going into Denver and beating the Nuggets 109-106. And in the process, they now do something they have hardly done at all. They had lost 8 of 10 to Denver, got swept last year for the first time since the 2008-2009 season by the Nuggets, and now they come in and get a win on the road. This was a really interesting game to me because this was the complete team win in every sense of the word. Luka was not very good last night. KP was not very good last night. The two combined for just 22 points. Let me tell you the exact stat lines for them here. It was nothing to write home about. In this game, KP shot, let me see here, 4 of 14, including 1 of 8 on 3. Now, he did rebound much better. This is KP's best rebounding game as a Maverick. He gets 14 boards, 10 points, 3 assists, and 2 blocks. Great performance from KP, and at least in terms of crashing the glass. Not shooting the ball, that wasn't a great night for him. But it's fine because the bench really showed up. The bench wasn't there against Portland. It was a very performance from the bench. The bench scored 60 points tonight because 9 of 10 Mavericks who played got you double-digit points. The one exception was the returning Dwight Powell. He played only about 14 minutes, had 4 points and 4 boards. So you would guess, had he played the full game, he might have actually been able to get you maybe closer to that, and you might have had all 10 guys give you 10 points. So that's stellar there. Luka also struggled, 12 points, 4 rebounds, 5 assists on 3 of 12 shooting, and 1 of 6 from 3. I don't know what it was, if it was the high altitude that was a little bit of a problem for Luka, or if he just kind of got the wind knocked out of him. He did not look his usual self, though. I'm not too worried about it because, you know, you're going to have rough stretches like this. He played against a good Portland team and then had to go into a very good game against the Nuggets. So it happens. It happens. I'm not especially worried about it, but that is something to kind of keep a pin in and see how the team is able to respond going forward. They're going to have the Lakers now back at the AAC on Friday night. Seth Curry got his first start this year for the Mavericks and in 25 minutes gave you 10 points, 2 rebounds, 3 assists. I like what Seth Curry can bring to this team. Again, it stayed pretty much in line with his minutes and his points as what we've seen in previous games for the Mavericks this year. So it's not like you finally put Seth Curry into the starting lineup and just everything opened up and it was just a whole new world for the offense. Not at all. But this is still, it's still encouraging to see. You know, we're going to keep churning lineups out because we want to see, all right, what combinations of guys work better? Sometimes it's just purely matchup driven. Other times you're just working within your own chemistry and you're trying to see what guys can you build some rapport with. And that feels like what Dallas is doing because we've had drastically different lineups in pretty much every game this year. The one constants have been Luka and KP. Go figure. As well, you have Dorian Finney-Smith. He started out having a rough go. Paul Millsap was cooking the Mavericks early on, but Dallas was able to survive that. And shout out to Maxi Kleber, man. He's the high point man for the night with Tim Hardaway Jr. at 14 points. Maxi also had 7 boards on 6 of 12 shooting. Hardaway Jr., his first pretty serviceable night of the year, I feel. He had 14 points, 3 rebounds, 2 assists on 5 of 9 shooting and 4 of 6 from 3. This is the first night where he pretty much shot at or just over 50% for the Mavericks. It'd been a rough stretch. If you saw that Portland game, you know it was a really rough stretch for Tim Hardaway Jr., but this is the kind of game where he can give you a huge lift. And in a game where your high point man is 2 guys with 14 and everyone else still reaches double digits with the exception of Dwight Powell, you know that not only is the bench mob good, you know that the team is balanced. At halftime, for perspective, at half, your high point man was Justin Jackson with 10 points. Now, while I would say, hey, there's your importance right there of Justin Jackson, 4-4, 10 points at half. Yeah, 10 points isn't going to blow you away, but in a game like this where you kind of don't have any business being in the game, let alone I think Dallas was down 1 at half, 61-60, it's everything to do with guys like that can keep you in games. Think back to the second round of the playoffs in 2011 against the Lakers. Game one, Dallas is down 16 in the second half, and Corey Brewer is who gets them going. That's the kind of thing. Like, you sometimes need those guys who are, they're good players, they're not bad, but they're not stars, they're not typical starters or anything like that. But for whatever reason, you insert them into heavier minutes in that situation, and they can keep things afloat for you. And that's kind of what I felt like Justin Jackson did in this situation. So Dallas, man, I like Tyler Adams' tweet here during the game. He says, it's almost like DeLon Wright, Seth Curry, and re-signing Dorian Finney-Smith to bargain contracts is a better way to build a team than to basically money whip a guy with bad medical history and then give up picks to get him in the process. Not a bad example here for this. If you want to make that argument, and I think it's a good argument, this is definitely the game to point to for that sort of thing, because two nights earlier against Portland, you're kind of looking at that like, yeah, this team needs a third guy. They really need a third, like, legit guy. But hey, when your bench is going to give you this kind of production, you can overcome it. Now, there were some ugly things in this game. Not the defense. The defense late was very good from Dallas. Dorian Finney-Smith and Maxey, I thought, played great. Forced Denver into really tough looks at the very end of the game there. And so they're able to secure the win. But free throw shooting, man. 14 of 24 on free throws. That's 58%. But Dallas won on the road in a very tough environment. Like, that is probably the best measurable for grittiness I can think of for this team. The complete team win and overcoming adversity even when things aren't working well for you. And I don't just mean Luka and KP not balling out like you want them to or need them to, really. But also, free throw shooting. I mean, that's concerning. But at the same time, I feel good knowing the team was able to overcome that. It gives me a little bit of reassurance moving forward. Here's Micah Adams on Twitter. The Mavericks just won a road game against a team that might finish first in the West in a game in which Doncic and Porzingis shot a combined 7 of 26 with 6 turnovers. 9 players in double figures. Can we please put to rest the fallacy that Dallas doesn't have much beyond the two stars? Yeah, I think that's a fair assessment for sure. They have a good bench, and I've been saying that all offseason. I was saying it all through preseason and even in the start of the season. Dallas had last year, before J.J. Barea's Achilles injury, part of the ankle, they had one of the two or three best benches in the league. Now, Barea hasn't even started or hasn't even played yet this year. Neither has Boban. I know I want to see more Boban at this point, or any Boban at this point. But Dallas, I said, would have a very good bench. They already had a great bench last year. Yeah, J.J. Barea was kind of the maestro who ran that whole show. But you brought in some other scoring options. You brought in some other assets that were going to give you a lift in that regard. And even though Curry started tonight, so you can't count him as part of the bench, you get 61 out of your bench. To give you comparison for that, the Nuggets had 22 points out of their bench. Like, that's where the game was won and lost. You're not always going to have, most nights you should have, your Luka and KP wreck and shop. But on nights that you don't have them, it's really comforting to know that you have a complete team with continuity, with consistency, that you can lean on to score a tough win. Because this is a game, like I said, you probably should not have won this game. Like, going into Denver, my expectation for them was kind of what I felt the previous game against Portland. I just wanted to see Dallas come out and hang tight. I wanted to see, okay, hang around for 3.5 quarters, and then let's see what happens. Maybe Luka goes off. Maybe KP goes off. Maybe you get some kind of lift from DeLon Wright, who, by the way, had another solid game as well. Seth Curry, maybe you get something out of guys like that, and it elevates the team, and then, hey, maybe you can steal one, but if not, I'm not expecting them to. I'm hoping they can, but I'm not expecting it because, again, Denver is right up there with the Blue Bloods right now. I guess Blue Bloods isn't the right term because that's like a historic thing. Right up there with the elite of the Western Conference in terms of complete teams, in terms of just overall skill. So I feel really, really good about where this team is. And now it's just a matter of building upon it. Let me see. I want to see if there's any other notes I missed here. This is a shorter look here. Here's Carlisle after the game talking about Luka and KP. He says, look, Luka and KP are going to be at the top of everybody's game plan list with a mixture of double teams, physical defenders, you name it, plus the kitchen sink. Luka and Porzingis combined to shoot. This is after the quote. So, end quote, Luka and Porzingis combined to shoot. Score just 22 points, but the Mavs still won in Denver 109-106, says Dwayne Price on Twitter. Adding to that, you have Mark Folliwell, who's talking about this. He said the Nuggets played. Now, it is important to note, I glossed over this earlier. The Nuggets were on the second night of a back-to-back. They had gone to Sacramento the night before. However, this is also something to keep in mind. Like, you might want to take that with a grain of salt, but then maybe take half of that grain of salt away, because as Mark Folliwell points out, they were a league-best 12-1 on the second night of back-to-backs last season. This is a team who, second night of a back-to-back, true, but it's never really hurt them before. So for Dallas to come out and snatch this win, let alone in a fashion that you wouldn't have expected or even possibly dreamed of, is phenomenal. With tonight's Mavs win, Denver lost on the second night of a back-to-back for the first time since a road game in Atlanta that was at the end of a five-game trip last December. So, first time they've lost the second night of a back-to-back since December of last year when they had to go to Atlanta. That is pretty impressive for them. I mean, that says a lot about how good the Nuggets are in this case and why this is such a quality win for the Mavericks. So, I'm feeling very optimistic about this. Our next game now, we're going to have Friday night, as I mentioned, against the Lakers. This is going to be a really good matchup for Dallas. Anthony Davis had himself a really, really good game the other night. I think it was a 40-20 game. Dallas is going to have a lot to overcome. Both teams are 3-1. But you know what? There's a lot to be positive about here. Obviously, you have injuries with the Lakers. Kuzma's out. Rondo's out. No surprise. Cousins is out. I don't know why. It's almost like not even worth mentioning him from Bleacher Report's perspective. But this is going to be a good matchup for Dallas and a chance to see. All right, here you go. We're going through a brutal stretch of matchups here. Portland, Denver, LA. Then you're going to have Boston. But you're going to have a tough stretch here. And so far, Dallas hung tight, had every chance to win that Portland game, and then stole one against Denver. If you want to be a playoff team in the West, if you want to be a team that can overcome adversity in a stacked Western Conference, you're going to have to be able to find a way to win those games. And so far, 1-1, I would actually give them credit for Portland too, or sorry, the Pelicans game too, because in that case, they look like a team, especially when Zion gets back, that's going to be right there in the thick of things for the final Western Conference playoff spot. So, far as I'm concerned, Dallas is 2-1 in these games where you're like, okay, here's real measuring stick moments for you. Where do you stack up? So far, I'm pretty damn impressed. So, that's all my time for this. I know this was a little bit more of a hastily thrown together review, summary, whatever you want to call it, this morning. But all the same, I will be back. I'm going to try and do one Friday night as well before I go out of town for the weekend. I don't know that I'm going to get to do these after every game. That I don't want to promise that, but I am going to try to do it after the majority of games. So that's all my time. Thank you for watching. Until next time, guys, remember, every legend was once a prospect. Salute.